Hello and welcome to the Business of Story. I'm Park Howell and I am so glad you're here because I'm excited to share with you an encore episode featuring the author of one of my all-time favorite books called The Storytelling Animal, How Stories Make Us Human, Johnathan Gottschall. In our conversation, you'll learn why your minds yield helplessly to the suction of story, in Johnathan's words, and as a bit of a sidebar, how he took on stodgy, conservative academia in his book, The Professor in the Cage, Why Men Fight and Why We Like to Watch, that documents his story of becoming an MMA fighter to see how it would impact his teaching career. All that and more on this edition of The Business of Story. I drew a blank on my locker combination, even though I had opened it 1,000 times before. I stared at it through a haze of numbers that were swirling around in my head. I was a junior at Bothell High School, and the night before, I was nearly knocked out by a right hook from a long, lanky guy in boxing class at the Kirkland Boys Club. I realized I was probably a better storyteller than a fighter, and that was pretty much the end of my pugilist career. Fast forward several decades when I found myself in a different kind of bout. This one was much more cerebral. Turns out I'm better at taking blows inside my head instead of alongside my noggin. I was an adjunct professor of practice at Arizona State University, teaching sustainable storytelling in the Executive Masters for Sustainability Leadership. As part of the faculty, I was invited to a special lunch with the famous sci-fi writer and futurist Margaret Atwood. You probably know her as the author of The Handmaid's Tale, which was made into a TV series. The topic of the lunch was this: does science fiction play a role in science? I was one of 12 faculty members invited to the lunch, given my work in sustainable storytelling. 10 of my colleagues were PhDs, and the 11th was my friend Peter Bick. He teaches documentary filmmaking at ASU. When everyone introduced themselves, they were sure to announce their doctorate pedigrees, with the exception of Peter and I. We were, well, you know, the underclassmen in the room, and you could feel the feigned jabs of superiority tossed our way. Once the chicken croissants and Caesar salads were served, one by one our lunch companions shared their views on science fiction versus science. Even famed Professor Lawrence Krauss, the founder and director of the Origins Project at ASU, joined the conversation via Zoom. Strangely, he was coming to us from the back room of an auto dealership somewhere in Oregon on his way back from Europe, as I recall. The consensus among the docs was that the folly of science fiction had little place in informing the hard, objective truth of science. Well, I remained relatively quiet for the better part of an hour, listening to their arguments. One professor sitting directly across from me finally said what it appeared everyone was thinking. "Science fiction has no place in science," she declared. That's when I bobbed and weaved my way into the conversation. I said, "Didn't President John F. Kennedy use science fiction to raise $24 billion for the Apollo program to put a man on the moon?" He said, "We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard."
But if I were to say, my fellow citizens, that we shall send to the moon 240,000 miles away from the control station in Houston a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, the length of this football field, made of new metal alloys, some of which have not yet been invented, capable of standing heat and stresses several times more than have ever been experienced, fitted together with a precision better than the finest watch, carrying all the equipment needed for propulsion, guidance, control, communications, food, and survival on an untried mission to an unknown celestial body, and then return it safely to Earth, re-entering the atmosphere at speeds of over 25,000 miles per hour, causing heat about half that on the temperature of the sun, almost as hot as it is here today, and do all this, and do all this, and do it right, and do it first. Before this decade is out, then we must be bold. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
If that's not an example of science fiction informing science, then I don't know what is, I said. The professor looked at me, took a beat, turned to peer over her right shoulder at the person sitting next to her and said, "Well, we haven't heard from you yet, Dr. Jackson." She totally blew me off. Slipping the punch, I turned and looked at Mrs. Atwood. She gave me a subtle smile and nod as if to say, "Well played, sir." In my gut, I've always appreciated how the emotional power of story can impact and bring human context to the empirical nature of science. Science in and of itself is fiction until proven otherwise. And given that we Homo sapiens storytelling animals think, plan, organize, and act using stories, then it's hard to beat down the concept that science fiction does indeed inform science. As you'll hear in today's show, storytelling was the very first technology our ancestors used, long before the wheel, before agriculture, long before the fire, to ultimately survive the savanna and thrive right here on planet Earth. Oh, and even put a man on the moon. Bam!
The bad news is it's a challenge, and it really is very difficult to be heard these days. The good news is that the DNA, the basic structure of storytelling, never changes. So all the digital technology is taking off, and all these new tools are emerging. But at bottom, the structure of stories is now as it always was, and as it probably ever will be.
Johnathan Gottschall is an American literary scholar who specializes in literature and evolution. He holds the title of Distinguished Fellow in the English Department of Washington and Jefferson College in Pennsylvania. He is the author or editor of now 9 books, including, as you know, one of my all-time favorites, The Storytelling Animal, How Stories Make Us Human. It's about the evolutionary mystery of storytelling, about the way we shape stories and how stories shape us. The New York Times gave it its Editor's Choice selection, and it was a finalist for the Los Angeles Times Book Prize. Gottschall's latest book came out in 2021, called The Story Paradox: How Our Love of Storytelling Builds Societies and Tears Them Down. I hope to get Johnathan back on the show to share his insights from The Story Paradox. But for now, enjoy my conversation from several years ago on the timeless technology of storytelling with Johnathan Gottschall.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to Johnathan Gottschall. Welcome, Johnathan.
Hey, thanks, Parker. Thanks for having me on. It's always good to talk with you.
Yeah. Well, you've been a speaker a couple times to our class over at ASU, and what I've always been fascinated about and what you talk about in your background is how you study this intersection between art and science. And when I found your book, The Storytelling Animal, is when our youngest son was going through some challenges with some encephalitis, and he had to have some brain surgery, and it all worked out great, In my studies, as I was understanding what he was going through and reading, I suppose, more pop psychology than anything, because that's what my brain could download, I came across your book in The Storytelling Animal, and it really helped me bring everything together as a non-academic at the time, or not a brain scientist, but why stories work on our minds. So let me ask you that, Johnathan. Why are we the storytelling animal?
Story has this enormous role in human life, and it's such a huge part of our life. It takes up so much of our lives on Earth, everything from our daydreams to our night dreams to the stories that we spin in traditional fiction, to our conspiracy theories, arguably to our religions. Everything in human life, so much in human life, is constructed in story terms. But it's so much a part of our lives that we rarely think about it. We rarely ask ourselves that those big sort of why questions. And so storytelling is kind of an evolutionary mystery. Why does the human species spend so much of our time constructing stories, consuming stories? And the answer is probably multi-part. You know, we enjoy stories. That's one reason. There's probably parts of storytelling that have no purpose at all. But most biologists, most literary scholars who looked into this also think there's a sort of adaptive role for storytelling. A story serves a purpose in our lives, for instance, as a way of testing out competing scenarios. So you get to try out in your mind what it would be like to follow different courses of action, and you get a lot of vicarious experience from the stories that we consume.
And as the guy that not only consumes massive amounts of stories, but writes them and publishes them, what do you see are the biggest challenges with companies and content marketers, and where now everybody can be an author of their own reputes online? What are the basic things that they miss in telling a story that will really resonate?
Well, this is a wonderfully exciting time for story in all of its forms. There's all these technological innovations, and as you say, everyone now has access to publishing. So we can publish on Facebook, we can publish on Twitter, we can publish on our blogs. There's no gatekeepers controlling access to the marketplace. So that has created wonderful opportunities, but also incredible challenges, because there's such a cacophony of storytelling out there. There's so much out there. It's so hard to break through with your own message. It's so hard to actually be heard. So, you know, one of the things that people can do in that case is, you know, you can't opt out. You have to get involved in the contest of stories, where the sort of the best story will win. And so a lot of my work has sort of been focused on that. You know, how can people in the business community, the work that I've done with the business community, I should say, how can people in those fields who don't necessarily have a humanities background, who haven't studied literature in college, who weren't creative writing majors, how can they learn to be more effective storytellers?
And do you have one, two, or three tips that you can point them to that they could use right away?
Sure. I mean, what I've tried to do, to be honest, is just sort of transfer the wisdom of a basic creative writing class over to people in what I call the sort of persuasion and communication trades. So, you know, one of the things that you'd learn, you know, very early on in a creative writing class is that story has a very predictable structure. Stories are not endlessly variable. If you look at like a face, for instance, you know, there's a big difference between my ugly mug and Brad Pitt's mug. You know, but there's a certain structure. The nose is going to be about in the same place. The eyes will be in the same place. The mouth will be in the same place. And so story is the same way. You know, there's a big difference between a really cruddy story and, a great work of literature, for instance. But they're both basically following that basic structure. And the structure is very simple. It's simple, but if you don't employ it, you have very little chance of telling a story that's effective, that rivets human attention, that gets us that works its way into our memories, gets us to feel differently, think differently. And I call that structure problem structure. It's as simple as that. Stories are about characters. The character has a problem or a predicament. They have some sort of trouble in their lives, and they attempt to solve it. Stories have this problem-solution structure. And the knottier the problem, the thornier the problem, the more creative the solution, the more it sort of picks those locks in our brains. And the locks open up this capacity in the brains of what psychologists call narrative transportation, that sense we get of being lost inside a story, of losing ourselves in Neverland. And when we lose ourselves in Neverland, we become, we reach a sort of mental state that's very appealing to communicators. We're more open-minded in that condition. We're more open-minded inside a good story, and we're more persuadable. We're more likely to be able to change our mind about things.
Mm-hmm. You've got a really terrific article among many in Fast Company magazine, I believe, where I read it, where you talked about story being the Trojan horse, that it's the best way to actually deliver data is through storytelling. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yeah, so, I mean, basically that the metaphor of the Trojan horse is that story is a kind of vehicle for a message. And so the story of the Trojan horse is just about everybody will remember. The Greeks, you know, are fighting this war against Troy, and they decide to they pretend to sail away. They leave the Trojan horse at the gates. The Trojan horse is packed with warriors. The Trojans look at it, and they just see it as a wonderful gift. It's very beautiful, and they pull it into the city, and of course they're pulling their doom into the city. And the idea is something similar to that happens with story, that story can act like a Trojan horse that smuggles information and smuggles a message into the human mind. We always look at a story as a gift, just like those Trojans did. We can't help but be compelled by them. We can't help but love the story. But it often smuggles in information that we didn't necessarily bargain on. As you can hear or sense, this is a pretty ugly metaphor. You know, the metaphor of death and destruction and right? A storyteller as a manipulator and a liar. So we don't have to look at it that way. The story can also smuggle in information that is completely harmless, completely helpful to the reader or to the consumer of the story. But as that metaphor suggests, a story is a very, very powerful thing. It's not necessarily a good thing. If you have an evil person, they can use a story very effectively to mm-hmm. evil ends, but the story is a very powerful tool of communication and persuasion.
Well, and that's one of the rules of listening to the business of story is you can only use this for good and not evil.
Yeah, right.
Jonathan, you were talking a little bit earlier in the program about winning the contest of story out there, that how technology has leveled the playing field, and we can all be our own poets, authors, musicians, producers, and share our stories with the world, which creates, of course, this amazing cacophony of communication and the attention economy. And you talked a little bit later about a story structure, this problem solution. Is it as simple as coming down to the three basic structural elements of story, of exposition, conflict, resolution?
In some ways it is, yeah. I think in some ways it's exactly that simple. People resist that because we want to see a story as very, very complex, almost magical form of art. But, you know, it's, yeah, when you get down to it, it's really, it doesn't mean you, once you have those three elements, you're going to tell a good story. I mean, there's still a huge amount of work to do, a huge amount of work in craftsmanship and art. The big thing that I tell my students, and I think this is a useful thing to people to tell people in the business fields as well, is that you know, you look at a story you love, a movie you love, a TV show you love, a novel you love, and if it's any good, probably by the end you're saying to yourself, well, I could never do that. That's really hard. That looks really, really hard. And in fact, it looks more than hard. It looks impossible. This person who did this must have been a real genius. And there is a certain level of genius involved. But for the most part, great storytellers are really made and not born. One of the things that we talked about in the past, Park, were these manuscripts you can look at from great writers. And you can see, you know, this, you know, a great novelist, a Nobel Prize-winning novelist even, and you can go back to their manuscripts and you can see how hard they're slaving at things. You can see that this work did not come naturally for them. They were working very, very hard at their work. And I think that's a big lesson for all storytellers to take home. All we see is that beautiful finished product. We don't see the hard, brutal slog that the storyteller went through to get to that beautiful, polished final point.
Well, that's a really good point, because I'm in the throes, too, of writing my book on StoryBuilt, and I've gone through a couple versions of it, have had a couple editors look back at it, and you know, I'm working through that, and I have that same pain, I suppose, that all first-time authors have, like, man, is this really going to be that good? I'm just trying to transfer all this knowledge. And when I read The Professor in the Cage, and I just love how you tell a story, and as you know, I could relate to so much of it, because the short story in this, and I'll turn it over to you in a second, is that you've been this teacher, this professor for so long, and in your late 30s, you decided that you wanted to study and write about why men fight and why we like to watch this, and so you put yourself into an MMA program, did I say that right? MMA program, and became a cage fighter, spent 3 years in the cage, and then had your ultimate bout. But what struck me in all of that, as I was reading your book, I'm like, oh man, I got to start all over. Oh man, I got to start. It's written so well. But then I remember how many iterations, I think you showed us in the class, like 40 different iterations. And then at the end of it too, you also called out like 5 editors. And I'm thinking, whoa, you know, he didn't just tackle it on his own. Yes, he did the lion's share of the work, but you surrounded yourself with really good people. So can you talk a little bit about that process for us?
Well, you say, you know, that you have this problem as a first-time author. You're like, man, I just don't know if I can do it. I don't know if this is ever going to click. I don't know if it's ever going to come together. I don't know if this is going to be any good. I don't know if I'm going to humiliate myself. That's what all...
Check on that last one, exactly.
Well, you're vulnerable, man. You write a book, you write a story, and you put it out in the world, you're vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Especially in the social media age. So that's something I deal with all the time, is, you know, jerks and trolls, you know, just coming out of the woodwork and ruining my day with nasty reviews, you know. But, you know, so that's exactly... The emotional thing you're going through is exactly what I go through with everything that I write. It never goes away. It never gets easy. There's an upside to story, and the upside to story is that it's very, very powerful, man. If you can, you know, it's more memorable. We like stories. We like storytellers. It works its way into our memories. It persuades us. It's a really, really powerful tool of communication. But, and the but is enormous, the psychological studies show that none of this voodoo power that story has actually kicks in unless the story is actually good.
Mm-hmm.
That's the big if. And it's really hard to tell a good story. Not that you need to be the greatest artist who ever lived. Not that you need to be the most creative, high IQ genius who ever lived. But you at least have to have a temperament that lends itself to good storytelling. And it's usually a sort of, no matter what genre you're working in, it's usually basically a writer's temperament. Someone who can sit down for hours and hours a day, sit there heroically in his or her chair, sit through all the pain and suffering and doubt, sit there for years on end, if it means that, and finally in the end have confidence and hope that at the end there'll be a good story there.
Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit of background on yourself. You have been a professor, and you've been teaching English, and in your book, The Professor in the Cage, you've talked about getting yourself fired by becoming an MMA fighter, and the fact that you couldn't land that big academic career you talk quite a bit about in the book, too. And I asked myself, how can an author with your background and credentials not have already been accepted in that big academic career, you know, to move on? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, that's a bit of a sad story. I'm somewhat biased here, of course, so you're going to be hearing my point of view on this, and people in other academics, you know, who are not big fans of mine might have a different story about this. But, you know, I was doing, as you said at the outset in your introduction, I was doing this work in the humanities. I was a literary scholar, but I was very interested in questions about the nature of story. Why do we tell stories at all in the first place? How did human beings become a storytelling animal? It's a very strange activity for an animal to get up to. And so those questions I was addressing, I was interested in as a scholar, as an intellectual, as a writer, were questions at the intersection of the sciences and the arts. They were sort of in between. And so I explored ways of using sort of biology as a theoretical lens to get into these questions, and I pursued the use of quantitative scientific methods in a lot of my research. And I ended up basically pursuing a career path that was kind of a challenge to my entire field. And it was kind of a criticism of the entire field. I was very depressed and annoyed with the way that people in the field of literary studies in particular never figure anything out. They never get a sense of truer understanding of the questions that they're addressing. Mm-hmm. And so basically the field I'm in is fairly it's conservative. I don't mean conservative in a Republican or Democrat sense. I mean conservative in the sense that we'll keep things how they were. And my work is sort of a challenge to those sort of, you know, old-fashioned humanities traditions.
So jumping in the cage at what, rightful age of 38, was not quite the conservative demeanor your contemporaries were.
The problem with that was I was a few months short of 40 when I had my my fight. I trained for about 15 months, had the fight, and then trained for about 2 more years, and quit when I was about 40, maybe almost 42. Mm-hmm. And well, that wasn't about The reason I hoped I could get myself fired there was for two reasons. One, my bosses in the English department would literally be able to look up from their desks, look right across the street to the cage fighting studio, and see me fighting in the cage. And it's a huge understatement to say that people in English departments are not big fans of blood sport. You know, So I figured it would be a sort of scandal. I figured it would, cause a bit of consternation among my colleagues. But in fact, my colleagues kind of knew me, and they knew I wasn't a savage, you know, knew I wasn't a mean guy. Mm-hmm. But I do think it is a book that may help my dream come true of ruining my academic career. the reception from my colleagues and the larger intellectual community has been pretty cool so far.
So in the entire process of going and training and understanding why men fight that went into the book, what did you learn? What's the big moral of that particular story?
Boy, I don't know, man. I've never been good at elevator pitches. I'll say a couple things. One is, you know, I went into the cage, just to step back a little bit. What happened was this cage fighting gym opened up literally directly across the street from the English department. And I thought that was just kind of funny. I thought that juxtaposition of the savagery of the cage fighting gym with cultivated, cultured English department right across the street, I thought that was a crazy juxtaposition. And I had this thought, well, you know, maybe I'll go over there. And it was kind of a joke at my own expense at first. Joke was, you know, I'm almost 40. I've literally never been in a fight in my whole life. I have this incredibly civilized job. Wouldn't it be funny if I became a cage fighter? And my next thought was, well, you know, maybe there's a book in that, a sort of nonfiction version of Fight Club. I go across the street. I try to learn how to fight. But I'd also be doing it to ask these sort of big questions about the role that violence has played in human life. And going in, I did have a big idea in mind. And the idea was MMA, or cage fighting, is this perfect metaphor for something dark and nasty and rotten at the core of human life. And I wanted to use cage fighting as this way of exploring sort of the dark side of men. And then I go over there and I start doing the research. And basically all of my preconceptions about the sport, about the guys who did it, about the emotions and feelings that drive them into this combat, all those preconceptions I had were overturned. And I came to see things like cage fighting and other forms of sport, not as this, I don't know, metaphor for the darkness in men, but as one of myriad ways that men keep darkness in check. It's a way of channeling aggression down relatively safe pathways.
Well, it's a really fascinating book, and I highly recommend anyone that's interested in this. It's a very funny tale that Johnathan tells, and everything that he experiences in the process. So the storytelling is wonderful, but then what you find in the process about, you know, undercovering what you just said about why men fight and why we like to watch, and women, you know, this is, I think, is interesting to them as well. I know I kept reading segments of it to my wife all last weekend as I say, hey, check this out, and she would laugh at it. And
but yeah, great book. I've actually been very, very pleased. More than anything, the reception of the book by the reception of women readers.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of I've had a very warm reception from them because it's sort of, I think women have been attracted to it a little bit because it's a little bit of a cheat sheet to what, you know, sort of an explanation of some of the weirder aspects of men.
Kind of the insights to our knuckle-dragging ways is what you're saying.
Exactly.
Basically.
Yeah, precisely.
All right. And the last thing I'll say on the book right now before we throw to our next sponsor break is that it has to be like the best book cover I've ever seen designed. I think you and I talked about that a couple weeks ago. Just love the cover. So if you're listening out there, go check it out on Amazon.com, or do you have another website that you would want them to go to, Johnathan?
Oh, you could. I mean, you could also see my website, JonathanGottschall.com, and you can read about the book there and see some of the press about the book as well.
And that's Gottschall, G-O-T-T-S-C-H-A-L-L. JonathanGottschall.com. Well, Johnathan, as we round out the show today, I want to talk a little bit about, of course, this metaphor of all of us in marketing, communications, brand strategy, sustainability, wherever we're trying to communicate. It's an interesting topic. We are cage fighters in the realm of social media and trying to get our story heard through the contest of storytelling. So what advice do you have for our listeners if they are trying to cut through the clutter on Twitter? You've got 140 characters to do it, or to have a blog stand out a little bit more, or, you know, your 6-second Vine video to your 2 to 3 minute video long form. What can we all learn as an itch storytellers in our own way to make our work better in the simplest of ways to cut through the clutter?
It's a big challenge. The bad news is it's a challenge, and it really is very difficult to be heard these days. The good news is that the DNA, the basic structure of storytelling, never changes. So all the digital technology is taking off, and all these new tools are emerging. But at bottom, the structure of stories is now as it always was, and as it probably ever will be. And what that means is that people like you, people in this audience, can turn to the very best storytellers in the world and take advice from them. That's what I always tell people to do. Don't go read the business books on storytelling. Don't even go read my book on storytelling. Go read the creative writers. Go read the best storytellers in the language. So what I tell people to do, if you're very serious about this, go read books like John Gardner's On the Art of Writing. Other books on my shelves, you know, I have a number of them on my shelves. One of them is a great book, Stephen King's On Writing, a wonderful guide to the art of storytelling by a very talented and prolific storyteller. It's about 500 pages long, but I love how he boils it down to one sentence. He says, if you really want to tell stories well, you have to do two things. He's talking to writers, but this applies to all storytellers. He says, you must do two things above all. You must write a lot, and you must read a lot. So the idea of reading a lot is that you are studying how other people are doing it. So you find the people in the business community who are telling the best stories, and you reverse engineer how they do it. You take those stories apart, and you see how they tick. The other part of it is, you study up on the competition, King says, and at the same time, you write a lot. So King is saying, you must practice. This is really hard work. This is no day in the park. Great storytellers work very, very hard at it. And the last thing I'll say is when I'm talking to people, I always recommend that they actually write down their stories. So there's a lot of oral storytelling in the culture right now, TED Talks and Moth Story Hour and whatever else is taking off. But it's a sort of pseudo-oral culture. TED Talks are written out, they are drilled, and they are memorized. My story hour is written out. It is drafted. It is scripted, and it is memorized and then delivered in an oral fashion. A great stand-up comedian is, for the most part, doing bits that they've written down and rehearsed and just about memorized. So almost all great storytelling is based, at least in draft forms, on written versions. And I'd recommend that people actually write those stories down.
Well, that's a great point. I guess you don't know what you know until you write them down. And as I've learned, too, is you don't really know what you know until you actually have to teach it to somebody. So,
true.
You have been a terrific professor for us today, Johnathan, and I really appreciate your time. How long has your new book been out? And I know you've been really busy. Where have you been running around doing the book promo?
Oh, you know, it's been a really, you know, gratifying experience. People have really been liking it. I have wonderful reviews, you know, like Amazon reviews, that kind of thing. People have really connected with it. I've been doing, I've been in New York, L.A., you know, I'm going to Amsterdam in a couple of days. I've been running around, been pretty crazy.
Mm-hmm. Right on. I'll be over there in Amsterdam for our, at the end of June ourselves for our executive master's program. So all those students,
you met a couple weeks ago. We're missing each other. Yeah.
Well, again, if you want to see some of Johnathan's work, first and foremost, from a storytelling standpoint, highly, highly recommend The Storytelling Animal. Terrific read, filled with lots of great stories, but it shows you in this world why storytelling is not a gimmick. A lot of people think it is, but how we are actually hardwired beings for story. And I think my favorite line out of there that I saw that Brian Grazer used in his book, his new book about A Curious Mind, he borrowed from you of the what human mind yields helplessly to the suction of story.
So, yeah, just can't help it.
Thanks for listening to and sharing this edition of The Business of Story and for giving us a rating and review on iTunes. Man, that is so important because it helps us get heard in this noisy world. If I can help you and your people grow as more confident, compelling storytellers, well then, please shoot me a note to park@businessofstory.com. Or you can start right now with our ABTs of Agile Communications micro training course at businessofstory.com/ABT. Big shout out to Caden Howell, who edits our show, for the marvelous music from Darius Holbert, and for Marissa Hill helping me with all of my marketing and community development. Thank you so much. Join us next Monday to learn how to increase engagement with your coaching, training, and online courses with Salisa Steele. She has spent more than 20 years designing, developing, delivering, and marketing adult lifelong learning, continuing education, and professional development. You won't want to miss that show. And until then, remember that the most potent story you will ever tell, whether it's science fiction or not, is the story you tell yourself. So make that one epic. Thanks so much for listening.